Welcome to the GCN Tech Clinic, where I aim to get you riding your bike again problem-free. So if you've got yourself a bike tech-related problem, leave it down there in the comments section and I'll do my best to answer it in a future episode. Let's crack on though, shall we, with the first question this week. It comes in from John Potter, who's got themselves some Skinwall or Gumwall tyres on their bike, and they want to know, are they more susceptible to puncture than tyres without skinwalls? Right then, John, I love some skinwall tyres. They do make a bike look good. But why do they have skinwalls? Well, traditionally, those tyres will actually have the casing made out of cotton rather than nylon, meaning that those tyres are more lively than a cheaper tyre because cotton tends to be on the more premium tyres out there. What does that mean? Well, it means better flexibility. So if you were to encounter a bump or a stone on the road, that kind of thing, you kind of go over it more so than with a nylon type tyre where you just hit into it. Or at least that's the thinking behind it. As for are you going to get more punctures? Well, like I say, those tyres are more premium, so the rubber on them is generally going to be a little bit softer to aid with grip. But that doesn't necessarily mean punctures, although they may cut slightly easier, because you could go out riding on a really tough old tyre, riding along the road and get a puncture, and you could go along the exact same road using a track tubular, 18mm, silk casing and not puncture. So puncturing, okay, the tyre does play a part in it, but also bad road surfaces or just, yeah, riding through a hole, that could give you a puncture. So there's no actual science, not that I know of, that says a skinwall tyre is more likely to give you a puncture. Next question this week comes from Gabriel Barney, who says they recently installed a new power meter with a brand new rotor 3D crank on their bike. Since then, despite numerous attempts, they can't properly tune the front mech. They always get some very light chain rubbing there. Any tips? So, and they're using a Shimano Tegra 6800 front derailleur. Right, now this is a problem which I too have run into, and I think it's probably most likely happening when you're on the small chainring and the smallest sprocket at the rear, because I can't see why it would be touching your front derailleur at any other time really, other than if you're cross-chaining on those extremes. So, what you could do is fit an inline cable adjuster if you don't already have one, so that's onto the outer cable of your front gear cable, then that'll allow you to just get really fine tuning the actual amount of cable pull that happens. But in some cases, what it can well be is that the chainrings are spaced slightly different to a Shimano setup, which of course that front derailleur is designed to be working with. So they're slightly wider spaced, meaning if you're in the little chainring and the little sprocket, the angle is always going to be just a little bit too extreme and you're going to get that rubbing sound. Something drastic you could do would be to file away part of the actual spider of the chain set so you could get those chain rings a little bit closer. Personally, I wouldn't do that. I would rather use that rubbing sound as a reminder to not be cross-chaining. Next up, got a question from Christopher Melville, who says, how do I know which version of Shimano Tegra I have? Good question on this. Now, on all Shimano components, hidden away on them somewhere, is actually a little number which denotes which version you have. So take, for example, on this Shimano Dura Ace chain set, on this side of the crank, I've got FC7900, which is etched actually onto it. So that means it's the 7900 range, and the FC means front chain wheel. Then interestingly, on the other side, I've got FC7900/7950, because of course, a left-hand crank is a left-hand crank. 7950 would mean the compact version of this chain set. See where I'm going? Then bottom bracket, I've got BB7900. So again, the 7900 series. So have a look around. It's probably easiest on your cranks. So just on the inside of the crank arm like that, you'll find out which version of Shimano Tegra you've got. Next is a question from Oliver Sherman, who says, my Fulcrum Racing Zero wheel suggests running 25mm tyres, but I was wondering if it would be okay to run 23mm. Right then, Oliver, I imagine they recommend 25mm because they probably work better aerodynamically with the profile of the rim, and most rims tend to be getting wider these days. But don't worry, you can run 23mm if you wish to, but it is certainly worth considering going up to 25mm. I made the change and I've not looked back. The increase in comfort has certainly been worth it. Next question this week comes from Russell Zechner, who has to take some time off the bike because of a crash and wants to know what can he do to make sure the bike's ready to ride again. So Russell wants to know, should he keep his DI2 and power meters charged up during this time off the bike? Any other tips I can offer for the safe storage of the pride and joy? Right then, Russell, sorry to hear about the crash and the time off the bike. Let's talk about your pride and joy though. First up, give it a good old clean, so make sure that there's no mud, no dirt on it at all, anything like that. Give the chain some oil. DI2, leave that plugged in, not a problem there whatsoever. The power meter, it might be worth just taking out the battery, because any knocks of the bike or the cranks, generally that's going to give it a little bit of life and then it's going to start searching for a head unit. So just bear that in mind, although if you don't want to take it out now and it does drain, it's only a couple of pounds further down the line. Other tips is I always like to keep tyres inflated, that therefore actually just keeping the shape of the tyre on the rim so they're not going to get any awkward kinks in them. And then also don't keep it anywhere too hot, because that could dry out your cables as well as your bearings, as well as actually giving your tyres cracks in them from perishing. And then don't keep it anywhere too cold, because it runs the risk of getting some condensation and then that forms little puddles of water inside of bolt heads, that kind of thing, going rusty. And finally, cover it up with a blanket so that no UV rays start damaging any paintwork, as well as protecting it from any scratches from anyone who's getting a little bit too close to that pride and joy. Now, Philip Pitts wants to know, are 11-speed drivetrains more sensitive to chain alignment, making sure the wheels are centred in the dropouts? The mechanics at the Tour seem to have to take extra special care in changing a rear wheel. Disc certainly seems to take a few seconds longer. That's a good question, this, because, yeah, at the rear end there, there is more sprockets than obviously with a 10 or a 9-speed setup. But actually, for centering the wheel in the dropouts, it shouldn't make any difference at all, because the overlock nut distance does remain the same. But in the heat of a moment with a mechanic, and the modern rear mechs actually have quite a strong spring inside of them, they do have to also pull back that mech further and with a little bit more effort than previously, and then also get the wheel in place. But again, it does take probably a little bit longer if you're using a through axle too. But as for any alignment, no, nothing at all, because generally they simply put the chain into the highest sprocket, so probably the 11 tooth at the Tour de France, and then it's easier to actually line that wheel up and go in place. Now Jared asks, after lowering my stem 10 millimeters, I noticed there is a slight rubbing noise when I move my handlebars from left to right. Is it possible that I removed too much grease from the bearings in the head tube on such a small procedure? I did take everything apart, but did not apply grease, as the bike is brand new and only has 2,000 miles on it. Sounds like a weird one, this one, Jared. Personally, I would always grease those headset bearings, because a lot of water can actually come up off the road and get in there. So put plenty of grease in there and then see if it still makes that noise. Alternatively, maybe you've done up the headset top cap preload a little bit too much and it is giving you a slightly rough feeling as well as the noise. So just check that out. Headset bearings, they are pretty fragile things, I must say. So if there is any misalignment or rough abuse on them, they do wear out really, really fast. And finally, just make sure it's not any outer cables that are rubbing or causing those noises, possibly in the frame stops too. Now, Jakub 1910 alias Krusty01, probably one of the weirdest usernames I've ever seen, wants to know, they were thinking about making an upgrade for or under 100 euros, and they were thinking about swapping the stock 23mm Continental Ultra Sports for GP4000s. Should they get them in 25mm or 28mm, or what else is worthy of an upgrade in that budget? Nice question. I think tyres really are probably the best upgrade you can make for that kind of money. So as for going for them, yeah, those tyres, the GP4000s, are absolutely brilliant. I use them, and I have used them for a long, long time, and I found them flawless. As for what width to go for, well, that depends on your frame, because some frames can't actually accommodate a 28mm tyre. I know one of my bikes at home, I tried to put some 28s on and it wouldn't get round. It wouldn't actually clear the seat tube as well as underneath the rear brake stay. So make sure that they can fit if you are going to go down the 28mm route. Alternatively, just think about going up to the 25mm first, because the 28s, well, they are pretty large and it can look quite weird at first when you're looking down riding, and you might not really appreciate such a big jump. 5 millimeters doesn't sound a lot, but it can be quite a lot when you're riding along, and maybe you'll regret it. 25 millimeters, I am so confident that you wouldn't regret going up to them. Now, Richard Isaacson wants to know, why are shift cables and brake cables, both inners and outers, different from one another? Good question, this. Firstly, let's look at the brake cable, shall we? So, they need to be able to stop both you and your bike. So, they do need to be a little bit thicker, because obviously that's a lot more pressure and weight that is being applied to those cables. Whereas a gear cable, well, it just needs to be able to move a derailleur one way or the other. It doesn't really require a lot of strength. The outer cables though, well, outer gear cables, they have strands of wire that run in one long line rather than a coil, because those long lines can't be compressed, so that means you're going to get better gear changing. And then the opposite really for your braking, because you don't want to have absolute solid brakes, you want to have a little bit of give there possibly. So I hope that clears it up for you. Now, Igor Bremek, final question this week, and one of my absolute favourites. Hi John, can I get a recommendation for a chain lube? I've recently degreased a Shimano chain, which has that nice factory grease on it. After re-lubing it with a cheap lube I had lying around, the chain is now noticeably louder. Is there a chain lube that's similar to Shimano's factory lube? I'd gladly sacrifice a watt or two for a quiet drivetrain. Right, Igor, the search for the ultimate chain lubricant. This is something which I'm currently actually undertaking. Last night, I put a picture up on Instagram of another product I'm trying, and well, I can't report back yet as to the exact results, but the best product I've found so far for as close to factory lubricant as possible, as you get on that Shimano chain, is actually something from a brand called KMC, who also make chains. Now this lubricant I searched so long and wide, high, low, whatever for, and I managed to track down a few bottles from a bike shop in Italy. The bad news is I bought those bottles, and as far as I'm aware, they don't bring those bottles into Europe any longer. So I don't know where you're from, but if you can find that KMC lubricant, I'm pretty sure you won't be disappointed with it. It does last pretty long time. It smells just like what comes on the chain, and I found it to be absolutely brilliant. But there is a whole heap of lubricants out there, and I'm sure there'll be lots of people commenting down below with the ultimate chain lubricant that they've found. So I'm interested to read those answers as much as you are. So there we are. That's the end of this week's GCN Tech Clinic. I hope that I've been able to answer your question. If not, leave me yours down there in the comment section down below, and I'm hoping I can get around to them. We do get hundreds and hundreds of submissions, and I really do enjoy tackling your little problems. Remember as well to like and share this video with your friends. Give it a big old thumbs up. Let everyone know about it, especially if they've got one of those problems I've just talked about. Don't forget too to check out the GCN shop at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com, where we have a whole heap of products, t-shirts, water bottles, riding kit, you name it, we've got it. And now for two more great videos, how about clicking down here and down here.